G'day guys, welcome back to True Footy El Caucho edition. Today we're going to be talking about the recent AFL trade period. There is so much to unpack and a lot of drama, potentially the most trade period drama I have ever seen since I've been following football. In today's video specifically, I'm going to be talking about the three biggest winners and the three biggest losers out of the trade period's events. Obviously today's video is not going to be that long, but if you would like to see some more in-depth analysis, we're going to be doing a good hour-long podcast on the weekend, really breaking down each team club by club, so make sure you stick around for that. By comparison, today's video is going to be shorter and concise, and it's just going to be simply who are the best three and the worst three performers over the past fortnight. Before I get into the video properly, guys, a couple of things to cover. First of all, our partnership with Manscaped, I'm excited to announce, is continuing. So if you head to manscaped.com and check out their elite premium products, you can use the code TRUEFOOTY20 and get 20% off and free shipping on all their products. Second to that, my second channel and podcast, Cole World, is alive and thriving. So if you don't mind, I'd really appreciate it if you go check out the link to that in the description as well. We've just released our sixth podcast. But that's enough of the shameless self-plugging. Let's get into the video. So I do hate to start the video with a negative note, but I have to address the elephant in the room. The Collingwood Footy Club are by far the biggest loser out of this trade period, and I'll tell you why. The strategy shown here by Collingwood throughout this trade period was nothing short of unprecedented, and in addition to that, it's not only unprecedented, but it's hard to see what the strategy actually was. Now, it's all been very well documented. You don't need me to repeat exactly what they've done. But in a nutshell, they forced out a number of best 22 players, presumably to save some cash in terms of salary cap. Forced out Adam Treloar, who obviously loved the club. He really wanted to stay, which is not something we've generally seen in the AFL landscape before. Clubs forcing out big name players who are on big, big contracts. Or at least if they do, it is a bit subtle and behind the scenes. In addition to Treloar, they've traded out Jaden Stevenson, another player who's contracted, wanted to stay, and in my opinion, actually has a lot of talent. I guess they had some issues with him, in particular his attitude and the way, you know, he committed to football in general, as it's coming out in the media at the moment. But he was pick six just 3 years ago, had a 38 goal debut season. And for me, I definitely think he was definitely worth persisting with. In addition to that, they have also offloaded Tom Phillips to Hawthorn as well, who was a little bit happier about the move by contrast, but it was still another significant contract to get off their books. In isolation, the Tom Phillips one kind of makes sense. He's probably a player that's sort of languishing in or around their best 22, but wasn't maybe worth the contract that he was playing on. It seems to be an issue with a number of Collingwood players. But if you look at their trade period as a whole, they've dumped what could only be about $2 million in salary cap, but haven't actually brought anything meaningful in. I think I saw somewhere Ned Guy half-heartedly mentioned that they felt they had a really good strong draft position and that was a focus for them, but they've got two mid-teen picks and then not a lot after that, so they don't actually hold a strong draft position despite getting rid of several best 25 players. They also came out at the start of the trade period and said their future first next year is on the table because Nick Dacos is going to be going to them through a father-son pick, so that would have made sense, but they didn't even get that deal done, so I don't really see how they've really progressed themselves. So the question is, why would they have conducted themselves this way this trade period? I guess there's probably two possibilities as far as I can see. First of all, and this is the one I kind of hope is true for Collingwood's sake, but potentially they're clearing space preemptively to land a big free agent. Now, during trade period, I heard managers talk about the fact that, you know, these deals, these big deals where players get traded from one club to another, often happen about 9 to 12 months before the fact. So there's a lot of groundwork to be made. So is it possible that Collingwood, say, for example, have a verbal agreement with Paddy Cripps to say, yes, you will be coming to join the Pies next year and we're going to make room for you now? Like I said, that is an optimistic way to look at it. For me, it doesn't entirely make sense as well, because you'd be relying on a verbal agreement, and players turn around on verbal agreements all the time. If you look at Andrew Caff, who verbally agreed to join North Melbourne a couple of years ago and decided not to, it seems unlikely that Collingwood would make huge moves to their list without something more concrete than a verbal agreement. Additionally, these particular moves are so detrimental to their best 22 for next year. Are they writing themselves off for 2021 in the hope that someone like a Paddy Cripps joins them the year after? That strategy doesn't make sense to me either. The second possibility that in my mind is potentially more likely is the fact that this is a product of mismanagement of contracts over a number of years. Now, obviously, they signed Brody Grundy on a massive deal. A lot of their players that they've traded in, like a Taylor Adams and, you know, Treloar himself, they've paid inflated contracts. It sounds like Tom Phillips was on about 600K a year. I don't know if that's true, but Mason Cox, again, they're talking about him being on in excess of $500,000 a year. This would make sense. I'm not surprised that Collingwood actually do have salary cap issues, but what doesn't make sense is that they would drop $2 million from their budget and not still be able to bring anyone in. If that is the case, then that is serious mismanagement and someone needs to lose their job. And that's why that explanation doesn't fully cut it for me either. If it is also a salary cap related strategy, then why not be honest with the player? It sounds like Nathan Buckley has actually told Adam Treloar, according to Treloar, that he wasn't wanted by the playing group. Now, is that just weird tactics to get a player out of the club? I don't know, but it just seems like very poor form. If Collingwood had come out and been honest about their salary cap issues, if that is indeed what it is, surely this whole trade period would have gone a lot smoother. What is interesting now is that we're seeing start of perhaps a shift in the power dynamic between clubs and players. Obviously, we see players bend their clubs over pretty much every offseason and the clubs get shafted. And this is kind of the opposite example with a club. They're sort of forcing players out to places they don't want to actually go. It's been a bit of a recurring theme with this particular trade period. We talked about Treloar and Stevenson, but then I think you also got to look at someone like Ben Brown. Probably didn't want to leave North if you'd asked him, but they obviously didn't want him. And someone like an Alex Witherden as well, even though Fagan seemed a bit more diplomatic with that, it was more or less saying you should probably explore your options because we don't know if we have a future here for you. To me, that's more or less the same thing, but that's probably the correct way to actually go about it. In a way, I guess it's good that the clubs here have some power, but I think the way that Collingwood have dealt with this, it's really rocked the boat, and I'd be interesting to see what the ripple effect is going forward to their existing player group and their culture. What sort of effect will this have on the players that are still at Collingwood? Will they feel the same two-way loyalty? I don't know. That remains to be seen. Anyway, I've talked about Collingwood a lot, but I feel like that was a massive elephant in the room. We'll now move on to a couple of other clubs that I think probably had a losing trade period. The obvious one for me is GWS in terms of the strength that's left their best 22 and their lack of ability to find real replacements for them. I'm talking about Jeremy Cameron and Zach Williams in particular, are two very good players. Jeremy Cameron won the Coleman Medal some 12 months ago. Then they've lost a couple of role players in Aiden Corr and Zach Langdon, and then a couple of young first-round draft picks in Jai Caldwell, and Jackson Haitley left the club. At least they got something in return for Caldwell. It looks like Haitley's going to walk to Adelaide in the PSD. They did well from a draft picks perspective. Obviously, they got four top 20 picks, which is, you know, a good hand to hold. But for a club that's contending to weaken their best 22 in such a way without real replacements, I don't think you can call this a winning trade period. Now, they've gotten some good value recruits. Jesse Hogan, if he can get over his issues for pick 54, is an absolute bargain. There's obviously no guarantee to that, but at least that sort of is a replacement, although a speculative one at best. And then picking up Proust to fill a bit of a need for the Giants, it's been a need for a number of years, to actually have a permanent ruckman on the books will be a bit of a boost, but overall a massive net negative for a side that, again, should be contending for a premiership this year. Now, whether or not you agree that they're a premiership contender, that's fine, but I'm sure internally the Giants are loading up for another crack at a flag. The next side that's come out as a bit of a net loss, but I still think there's a little bit of room for optimism here, is Essendon. Now, they have lost Adam Saad, they've lost Joe Danaher, Orazio Fantasia, and Sean McKernan from their list. They've gained Peter Wright at a bargain, Jai Caldwell from the Giants, and Nick Hind from the Saints. Now, they were one of the sides that were embroiled in that late deadline day drama, obviously trying to get Josh Dunkley across from the Western Bulldogs, but ultimately the Dogs wanted an exorbitant price for a player like Dunkley, who's contracted, and that's fair enough. But I guess you could say if Essendon were going for their number one target and didn't pull it off, it's not an overly successful trade period. Now, overall, it is a net negative to their best 22, and in my opinion, I look at Essendon and I think they should be trying to play finals next year. They're certainly not rebuilding. But the reason I say there's a little bit of optimism here is that they also hold probably their best ever draft hand with picks 6, 7, and 8. And on top of that, only Adam Saad was a real loss to them. I think he finished pretty high in their best and fairest, third, if I'm not mistaken. And you look at guys like Joe Danaher and Orazio Fantasia, who, while very, very talented and had a lot of upside, weren't really offering much to the club in terms of on-field performance in the last couple of seasons. Look, I'm not really criticizing Essendon's trade performance here as such, because, you know, these players wanted to leave and they got a very fair return for them. And there's definitely something exciting about having three top 10 picks. We saw what happened with Port Adelaide in 2018. With three picks in the top 18. They got Rosie, Dersma, and Butters. Essendon are in a very good position to pull that off for their own list, but obviously there's no guarantees that's going to happen. So at the moment, I'm going to tick them as slight losers with a real opportunity here to generate some excitement. Now let's talk about the positive stuff. I'm going to name the three biggest winners, in my opinion, of this trade period. First of all, we've got to go with the grand finalist Geelong. Now obviously, they faced a couple of retirements this year, Harry Taylor and Gary Ablett leaving the club. So they obviously needed to make a couple of moves just to strengthen than that best 22 to go again next year. As far as additions to their list go, they've strengthened the most, in my opinion, with Jeremy Cameron, Coleman medalist from just 12 months ago, as I alluded to, joining the club and forming a very formidable 1-2 punch with Tom Hawkins, and now the Cats, whose weakness might have been having a genuine partner for Hawkins to take some of the focus away from him. They now hold the last two common medalists in the league. So as far as forward line goes, they're right up there with the best now. Top of that, for the next couple of seasons, at least you got an Isaac Smith and Sean Higgins there roaming the flanks and wings. With those two guys, they've seriously improved their best 22. Now, yes, to some extent, they're throwing away a bit of the youth, even though they did have a fairly strong draft hand last year. But we know that Chris Scott is adamant that this side is going to try and win a flag while they're all together. And to be honest, it's hard to argue with that view. Now, they've certainly traded out of the draft this year, but like I said, they had a strong draft hand last year, and they've virtually turned Tim Kelly into Jeremy Cameron, which overall is a very good deal. As far as I'm concerned, they're a flag favorite again, and they've picked up the best player on the move this offseason. Now, it's a great question. Will this strategy of recruiting experienced players continually and maybe foregoing the draft a little bit burn them down the track? Probably not if they can keep attracting players to come to Geelong. The next side that I think has done a fantastic job this offseason is Carlton in terms of strengthening their best 22. They've got Zach Williams as a restricted free agent, so didn't have to give up anything for him. They've added Adam Saad through pick 8, and they've recruited Geelong's Lachie Fogarty as well. I love this offseason because with Cade Simpson retiring, they targeted that they needed to add some run out of their back half, and they've gotten two of maybe not the absolute best in the business, but Williams and Saad are very, very good players for their role. I like this because they've taken what would have been a perceived weakness about the list and turned it into virtually a strength with those two players, and they've added a young, promising midfielder in Lachie Fogarty too. Now, I was a little surprised they went for Fogarty at all. I didn't really think young midfield talent was a big focus for Carlton, but I guess they see him as part of their future plans if they're willing to trade for him. Obviously, Carlton now no longer hold pick 8, but for a side that's been rebuilding for a number of years, they didn't need pick 8. They needed mature talent, players that are going to make them better in the here and now, and they've well and truly done that. So that's a big tick for Carlton. The third winner is the Western Bulldogs, and I've left them to last because I don't know if this is as a clear win for them as everyone seems to be making out. Yes, they get full marks from a negotiating standpoint in terms of the way they use their resources to improve their list. However, I do think they've kind of strengthened in areas that won't necessarily improve them that much. Now, it's well publicized they've brought in Adam Treloar, Stefan Martin, and Mitch Hannon from the D's as well. On top of that, they've done outstanding business downgrading pick 14 to 3 second rounders, which helps them match bids for Jamara Ugle-Hagan, who's likely to be pick 1, and that way they actually stay relevant in the draft after that. On paper, that is great business, and even getting Treloar for such a, it was virtually a second rounder the value equated to be. That is massively good trading from the Bulldogs. On top of that, you got Stefan Martin, who has come in as much needed ruck support for Tim English. They've more or less fed him to the Wolves over the last few years, and now he's got a little bit of a break. But I will caveat this and just say I don't know if this is going to improve the Dogs as much as people are suggesting. While they have undoubtedly gotten stronger in some areas, I think they could have done more to address their specific needs. Treloar is a fantastic player, and he definitely will improve the depth of that midfield, but was the midfield really an area they needed to improve? I don't really think so. In fact, I think they were struggling to fit in all their resources into that midfield as it was, with guys like Josh Dunkley moving out to a flank or at times, you know, second ruck. If Dunkley's already struggling with the idea of how do I get back into this midfield, adding Adam Treloar is only going to exacerbate that. Again, I'm not really criticizing the Dogs because, you know, picking up someone like Adam Treloar at a discount is never bad business. But we've seen that teams with good midfields who add another very good midfielder, they don't always actually get better. And in terms of Stefan Martin, I do think it is a good move to pick him up, but also that doesn't necessarily strengthen them in the immediate term either, as far as I'm concerned. It's more about shielding Tim English for some more smooth development. And they've picked up a forward in Mitch Hannon, which, you know, he's not a bad player at all, but for a team that, in my opinion, probably lacked a bit of scoring power, you know, Hannon averaged less than a goal a game this year. So again, doesn't really improve them in areas that need to improve. For me, I probably would have liked to see the Dogs push for maybe one of those discounted key forwards on the move this offseason. Someone like a Ben Brown for cheap would have been really good addition. Someone like a Tom McDonald, anyone just to sort of add another tall dimension to that forward line. Look, overall, I do agree that they've done great business. Sam Power has done an outstanding job. However, I'm just adding the caveat that I don't think they've improved their best 22 to the same extent as Geelong or Carlton. But anyway, guys, that is just my opinion. As always, I welcome yours in the comments. Let me know what you think of what I've said. As always, really appreciate you subscribing if you haven't already, or, you know, staying subscribed if you are already, and make sure you stay tuned for that upcoming True Footy podcast we'll be doing, talking about every team to some extent. Thanks, guys. I'll see you in the next video. Cheers.